praise God. And let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to The Bread Broadcast, a weekly Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exalt, we edify, and we also challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to talk about someone who is very important to me, is the reason you are seeing me. And he has helped me a lot along the way. He's my coach, he's my mentor. I mean, he's everything. But before we start talking about him and how he also can help you, let us pray. Father, we thank you because you are beautiful. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for you sit above the earth and you have made the earth your footstool. You do as you please in the armies of heaven. Nobody can challenge you. The Bible says, who can teach like you? We ask, O Lord, that you will teach us in this program through your word, that our lives, O Lord, will move forward. In Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Our title today is going to be The Ministry of the Holy Spirit in a Disciple's Life. I love it. The ministry of the Holy Spirit in a disciple's life. And I'm saying a disciple's life, not the disciples, as in the Bible. No, a disciple. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. If you follow the word of God every day and you live according to biblical injunctions, then you are a disciple of Jesus too. All right, so the case study today is a disciple of Jesus. So that means if you are a disciple of Jesus, a follower, indeed, you are a disciple, I am a disciple. So today, we are the case study. And our foundation text is Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. The book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 30, and I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation. I love the rendition. It says, and do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, he has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. The day of redemption is when the Lord comes and we exchange this body of corruption for the incorruptible body. Amen. All right. The list I'm going to be giving out, please, please listen to me carefully, is not, again, is not an exhaustive list of the ministry of the Holy Spirit in a believer's life. No, I do not even have the brain, or I've not studied that much to say that. I don't have that authority. But this is coming from my personal experience with the Holy Spirit and the experiences of other disciples of Jesus in my life, as backed up by the Word of God. But one thing is very clear. Whatever the Holy Spirit is doing in your life as a disciple is going to be 100% glorifying to Jesus and 100% backed up by the Word of God. If it's not, that is not the Holy Spirit, all right? So the first thing that you experience as a disciple of Jesus that the Holy Spirit does in your life every day is the engaging presence of the Holy Spirit. This is the conversational ministry of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not a force. No, No, he's not. He's a person. This means he wants to rejoice with us. He wants to comfort us when we are sad. He wants to tell us what we can do better when we get things wrong. You see, he wants to explain things to us. He speaks all the time if we let him. He wants to convict us. You see, there was a time I lied. He said, "Josephine, you just lied." "Oh, Father, I'm sorry." And I had to go back to say, "Let me correct myself." You see, that is one of his ministries in our lives. A disciple of Jesus who fails to have conversations with the Holy Spirit is missing out. And a disciple who is too engaged with their physical environment is in danger of not hearing the Holy Spirit. When he speaks, we need to learn to turn inward to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say to us. Don't say, "Oh, I'm always busy at work." Listen, if the Holy Spirit needs to pass on an information to you that will help you right there on the spot concerning your work, but because you are too busy running around your office, then he won't be able to do that. And you will get in trouble, you see. So you will be the one missing out. Let's go to the gospel according to St. John, chapter 14, verse 26. Gospel according to St. John, chapter 14, verse 26. But the Helper, this is Jesus talking to the disciples now, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, in Jesus' name, he will teach you all things. You see, you don't need your pastor to teach you the Bible. Thank God for pastors, for Bible teachers like myself, who have been gifted to break the Word of God down in bits that people will understand. But you don't have to wait for a Bible teacher to study your Bible. You don't have to wait for your pastor to study the Bible. Oh, no. He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. This was the Lord's promise. So if you're a child of God, let the Holy Spirit do his job. Now, if you're an unbeliever, the Holy Spirit has a different ministry for you. One of his ministry for you is to convict you of truth, which means, when a preacher is preaching, the Holy Spirit will let you know she's telling the truth. That is the Holy Spirit using your conscience to convict you. And the Holy Spirit is the one who draws you to Jesus. He encourages you. "Come on, you can do this. Give your life to Jesus." If you are hearing that in your spirit as an unbeliever, that is the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not you thinking it up. But for a believer, he speaks to us a lot. To be depending more on Christ is to be maturing more in Christ. You want to know how you are growing spiritually? You measure it by how you depend on the Holy Spirit. To be depending more on Christ is to be maturing more in Christ. Moving on. The restraining power of the Holy Spirit. And now, if you notice, I didn't say the ministries of the Holy Spirit. It's one ministry with layers. So when he comes into your life, he brings all these things in a package. So the restraining power of the Holy Spirit is the directional ministry of the Holy Spirit. He can do this by not allowing us to have inner peace concerning a decision or impressing something very strongly on our heart to instruct us in the way we should go, so we do not go into a path that God did not intend for us to go. He may also do this by making a particular passage from the Bible to have a peculiar meaning to us. Some people will say the word jumped at me. You see, that is the Holy Spirit showing you what you are to do. By directly speaking to our heart, the Holy Spirit does all these things to restrain us, either from going into the wrong thing or from doing the wrong thing or saying the wrong things. Let's look at the book of Acts, chapter 11, verse 12a. Acts 11, 12a. And we are going places this lesson, so I have to hurry. Then the Spirit told me to go with them, doubting nothing. This was Apostle Peter in the case of Cornelius when he was reporting to the church in Jerusalem how the Holy Spirit led him from Joppa to Cornelius' house. So in that case, the Holy Spirit said, you as a Jew, go. Don't worry. Go to Cornelius' house because Cornelius is a Gentile. Acts 16:6. Now, when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. This was talking about Apostle Paul and his team. You see, they were planning to go back to Asia Minor to continue preaching there, but the Holy Spirit said, no, don't. You see, in one case, the Holy Spirit told Apostle Peter, go. In another case, the Holy Spirit told Paul and his mission team, don't go, you see. So he guides us, he directs us. That is the restraining power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives the stop before we fly. Calm down, Josephine. Say that again. Because a lot of Christians, a lot of children of God, they will say, why didn't the Holy Spirit tell me? If you have been listening, he's been talking. The Holy Spirit gives the stop before we flop. Don't flop it. Moving on. The revealing light of the Holy Spirit. This is the illuminating ministry of the Holy Spirit. He's so beautiful, isn't he? The Spirit of the Lord reveals unto us things that we wouldn't have ordinarily known, either to encourage, to correct, to warn. If a sin is in disguise, it will warn you so you don't fall into that sin, or to teach us, or to call us to action. There have been so many intercessory actions that the Lord had called us in the ministry to, somebody we've not seen in a long time, and one or two people will say, I was just thinking about ABC, and we are like, ooh, we better pray. And when we see that person, at that point in time that we started praying, they were going through some stuff, you see. The Holy Spirit also reveals the motive of people to us, especially through discernment, which will have been impossible for us. There is one of us in this ministry, and God has really gifted this individual in that area. If you say good morning, that individual will pick it by the Spirit. If your good morning is truly a good morning, or you meant something. If you smile, this individual will pick it. If your smile is genuine or sinister, you see, that is the revealing ministry, the revealing power of the Holy Spirit in that person's life. Let's look at the book of Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13. Hebrews 4:13, it's a very popular verse. And there is no creature hidden from his sight. Remember, the Holy Spirit is God, the Spirit. So it's also God and it's also Jesus. But all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. This is one Bible verse that I like to say to myself a lot when I'm by myself to keep me on my toes. You may want to adopt that too. Like Josephine Zion, nobody sees you right now, but all things are naked before him, you see. There is no lonely secret before the Holy Spirit. Josephine Zion, they need to hear that again. If you think your secret is safe, no, it's not. It's an open scandal in heaven. There is no lonely secret before the Holy Spirit. Moving on. The enabling power of the Holy Spirit. This is the invigorating ministry of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. He empowers us to go the extra mile to do what would have been humanly impossible for us to do. For example, a rape victim who becomes a Christian, becomes a disciple of Jesus. Are you kidding me? It takes the power of the Holy Spirit for that rape victim to forgive the rapist. Look at our persecuted brothers and sisters all over the world whose families have been destroyed by ISIS, by Al-Qaeda, by Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab, and all that. Some of them, they had their children killed right before their eyes. It takes the power of the Holy Spirit, number one, not to deny Jesus at that point. When they were saying, you better say Jesus is no longer your Lord or we kill your baby. And they are saying, go ahead, I will meet my baby in heaven. That is the power of the Holy Spirit. It's the enabling power. He empowered them at that point to be able to stand and not deny Jesus. And also, the Holy Spirit empowered them to forgive that ISIS that chopped off the head of their baby, you see. The Spirit of the Lord also empowers us to live a daily holy life in a filthy world. Listen up. It's not by your power that you see something bad on the TV and you close your eyes. Or you go shopping as a man, you see a lady that is badly dressed, almost naked, and you are like, oh, I can't look at that. It's not by your power. It's by the power of the Holy Spirit. It helps us to live holy in a filthy world. The Holy Spirit enables us to run away from temptations so we don't fall into it, you see. If you are struggling with a sin, ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Literally. I love the way Dr. Bonnell said it. He said, if the enemy is trying to entice you to commit fornication or something, just say, Holy Spirit, would you like to have this? You will see how that your eyes will clear up immediately because you are like, oh, wait a minute, Holy Spirit, oh no, I can't let the Holy Spirit see something like that or be involved in something like that. You see, that is involving him in everything you do to let sin be far away from you. And the Holy Spirit will show you strategies to use so you can avoid the evil that is plaguing you. Let's look at the gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 12, verse 12, Luke 12:12. For the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. This is Jesus telling us now that when you are brought before the judge, you are being persecuted because of your faith, he said, don't worry. Don't think about what you are going to say because in that very hour, the Holy Spirit will tell you what to say. The power he gives is the power you need. The power he gives is the power you need. Moving on. The protective covering of the Holy Spirit. Oh, how I wish we had the time to expand on this. It's so beautiful. This is the defense ministry of the Holy Spirit, which often involves supernatural occurrence in a natural situation to protect his own from physical or spiritual harm. And let me tell you, the Holy Spirit is gentle, but don't mess with one of his own children. Ooh, to protect his own. The Holy Spirit may act against an invader or protect a child of God, or he can allow a light affliction to come to a child of God in order to stop us from heading into a bigger trouble. I don't know if you've heard of, testimonies of people that they will say they woke up late, they missed their flight, and then the plane crashed and all that. You see, it's not because they are better than the people that died in the plane crash or the people that were involved in an accident. It's not just their time. And the Holy Spirit said, I have the responsibility to protect you so you don't go before your time, you see. So he will do whatever he has to do to either fend that evil off or protect that child of God from going further into evil. Exodus 23, verse 22. This is God himself promising us. Exodus 23:22. But if you indeed obey his voice, you see, you have to obey his voice, which means the word of God has to be part of your life every day. And do all that I speak. You not only read it, but you practice it. Then I will be an enemy to your enemies and an adversary to your adversaries. You see, you don't want to be praying against your enemies anymore. You just stick to the Lord. All right? Make him your oxygen. Just stick to him. He will deal with your enemies. In fact, you look around and you know you don't have enemies, because he will have dealt with them, because that's the way he operates. He has that responsibility. His protective covering is a decisive governing. Did you hear that? Let me repeat myself. His protective covering is a decisive governing. You want the Holy Spirit to protect you with all the artilleries of heaven, then let him govern your life. Moving on. The preserving grace of the Holy Spirit. This is the maintenance ministry of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit preserves and seals us for Christ. Hallelujah. This is why it is biblically impossible for a child of God, a genuine child of God, sealed with the Holy Spirit, indwelled by the Holy Spirit, to walk away from Jesus. And there are so many wrong doctrines out there that we say you can lose your salvation if you don't hold on to it. Listen up. If you knew how to hold on to your salvation, how come you didn't get saved the day you were born? Huh? How come? You see, once you become a child of God and you are sealed by the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is inside of you. Listen up. There's nowhere you are going anymore. You are married to Jesus. He has his wedding ring on your finger. You can't walk away anymore. His wedding ring is the Holy Spirit in you. You see, you are his property. Now, a believer, a child of God, a disciple may fall into sin. But that believer, that disciple of Jesus, will always come back. Apostle John said, if they were one of us, they would have continued with us. You see, that is the sign. When you see someone that says, I walk away from Christ how many years ago, and they didn't come back, they were never saved in the first place. Oh no. If they were truly saved, their lives would be miserable. They would be back, you see. However, if such a believer, a disciple of Jesus, who has the Holy Spirit in them, if they fall into sin and the Holy Spirit is drawing them back to Christ and they refuse, listen up. If they continue in that rebellion, you know what the Lord will do? He will take them home to heaven before their time. They will die. Say what? Oh, yeah. Many Christians have died untimely because of that. Because they wouldn't come back to the Lord, they are living in rebellion, the Holy Spirit took them away. Because it's like the trouble is too much. Go home and rest, you see. The Bible says there is a sin leading unto death, you see. So some believers, they died before their time. The Holy Spirit also assures us of heaven. He is the connection between us and God. Why am I always talking about the rapture, always looking forward to the Lord to come? It's because I have the assurance, you see. John chapter 14, verse 16. The gospel according to St. John chapter 14, verse 16. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. There you have it in the words of Jesus himself. The Holy Spirit, once he comes into your heart, he abides with you forever. He doesn't walk away if you are truly saved. The Holy Spirit is done with you when you are done on earth and home on earth. I tell people, the Holy Spirit finishes his work in your life when he brings you to the throne of God and says, here is another one of your babies. He's on, she's on, saved and delivered. You see, the Holy Spirit finishes his work in the disciple's life when he delivers that disciple home at the feet of Jesus. Amen. So what have we done? What is the ministry of the Holy Spirit? The engaging presence of the Holy Spirit is his ministry. That is, he converses with us all the time. The restraining power of the Holy Spirit, he holds us back from going into evil. The revealing light of the Holy Spirit, he exposes concealed lies of the enemy. The enabling power of the Holy Spirit, he regenerates the supernatural ability in us to live a holy life in a perverted world. The protective covering of the Holy Spirit, he defends us against the enemy and protects us from hurting ourselves out of ignorance. The preserving grace of the Holy Spirit, it makes it impossible for us to enjoy living outside of Jesus, and he gives us the assurance of heaven. Hallelujah. Now, are you a believer? Huh? But you don't feel like the Holy Spirit works like this in you. You're saying, Josephine Zion, I don't feel all these things you're talking about the Holy Spirit. Listen up. Watch me. Come closer. You need to change your attitude toward daily Bible study and prayer. Let God alone be true and all men liars. If you are not feeling the Holy Spirit working in you according to this, then you are neglecting the word of God. You are too busy. If you neglect God's word and you're a prayerless believer, the Holy Spirit won't be able to operate freely as he ought in your life. You need to release yourself to the Holy Spirit. You are truly saved if you are, as you claim. That doesn't mean you don't have the Holy Spirit. If you're truly saved, the Holy Spirit is in you. But if you don't allow him, that they say what you feed grows. If you don't feed on the word of God, the Holy Spirit won't be able to grow in ministry in you. That's it. What you see is what you get. Okay? So what you put in is what the Holy Spirit will work on to grow you spiritually. Are you yet to give your life to Jesus? Huh? Listen, I don't mean to depress you, but I'm telling you the truth. If you don't have Jesus in your life, you don't belong to Jesus. You don't have this Holy Spirit in you. So your life is in danger. But here's the good news. That can change right here, right now. How? By giving your heart to Jesus. Right now, don't wait until next 2 seconds. That may be too late because your life is in danger. Satan can kill you at any time. Now, the moment you give your life to Jesus, guess what? the Holy Spirit immediately comes into your heart and you will have access to him and his ministry, like I've been teaching. If you want that, because if you don't, your life is in danger. But if you want to be out of danger, give your life to Jesus now. Now, I'm going to say a quick prayer, and I'll let you go to the link that will go that will come up shortly after I finish praying. Click on that link. We will meet you there. All right? Father, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Oh, Holy Spirit, you're so beautiful. And we love you. Thank you for what you do in our lives. We pray that you will help us to continue to submit totally to your governance, in our life, so you can grow your ministry in our lives. And for those who are going to accept Jesus, Father, I pray, let them know that a change, a good change, is coming to their lives, even as they experience the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.